ओमज्ञानतिमिरन्धस्याज्ञानञ्जनशलाखया चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः। नमो विष्णुपादाय कृष्णप्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदान्तस्वामिन् इति नामिने। नमस्ते सरस्वते देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेषा शून्यवादी पाश्चात्य देशतारिणे। जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासदी गौर भक्त वृंद। हरे कृष्णा कृष्ण कृष्णा हरे हरे, हरे राम 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 हरे हरे। सो इन द लास्ट वर्ड्स Kardama Muni referred to the six opulences that the Lord possesses: Aishwarya, Vairagya, Yasho, Avabodha, Virya, Shriya, Purtam, Aham Prapadhe. I surrender unto the Supreme Lord who possesses Aishwarya, complete. Purtam means complete. Purtam Aishwarya, complete wealth. Vairagya, complete renunciation. Yasho, complete fame. Avabodha, complete knowledge. Virya, complete strength. And Shriya, complete beauty. So here, in today's words, Kardama Muni is qualifying his statement because, yes, one may address somebody as the Supreme Lord and one may say that yes, you possess all the six opulences, but then that statement has to be qualified. That means, how does he possess these six opulences? How do we understand that? So that is being explained in today's verse. The different qualities which are mentioned, which the Supreme Lord possesses, which we can see verbally in this material existence itself, by this one can understand that the Lord possesses all these six opulences. So Kardama Muni begins by saying Param. So we understand that there are two things, Para, Apara. Apara means material, or that which is not transcendental. Para, Param, means transcendental. So he is saying the Supreme Lord has nothing to do with this material manifestation in that sense. He is completely beyond this. Just like we were hearing, I think it was in yesterday's class, Prabhupada was saying that even Shankaracharya says, Narayanaha para vyakta, the Supreme Lord, he is beyond vyakta and avyakta. Param. Then, Param Pradhanam, he is the Supreme. Just like we say Mukhya, Mukhya means out of among many people, one who is prominent or their leader. Similarly, just like we say Pradhan Mantri, the chief, supreme out of all the mantris. Right? So Pradhanam means he is the supreme. And what is he? Is he something impersonal? Yes, one may be transcendental, one may be supreme, but there is all possibility that one can be without any form. So Kardama Muni says, no, Pradhanam Purusham, you are the supreme person. And then further he says, Mahantam, you are the origin of this whole material existence. Mahantam. Kalam, this time is also a manifestation of your energy. Impersonally, in this material world, you are time. Kavim, you are fully cognizant. It is not that you are some dead stone. You are fully, completely cognizant. You are aware of past, present, future, all the times, everything is known to you. Then, Trivritam, Lokapalam, this material world, which is consisting of three modes of material nature, Trivritam, this is also one of your energies. And you are the maintainer, Lokapalam. No one else is maintaining. This whole creation is actually maintained by you. And then, something very important, Kardama Muni says, Atma Anubhutya, my dear Lord, whenever you descend in this material world, you don't appear by external material energy, by that help. Atma Anubhutya, whenever you descend either as Narsimha or Varaha or Kapila, you descend in your original supreme body, transcendental body, body not belonging to this material world. We all have to take body in this material world, but you don't. You descend with your original body. And then, what happens to this material existence? Anugata, when this material world is dissolved, it is absorbed in the body of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So we see that Mahavishnu, after the dissolution, everything goes and rests in the body of Mahavishnu. And then it says, Swachanda Shaktim, my dear Lord, everybody being a part and parcel of yours may possess some kind of Shakti, some kind of potency, some kind of power, but none of them are independently powerful. Everybody is dependent on someone or else. Even though somebody may be a great devata, but even they are dependent. They are not supremely independent. But Swachanda Shaktim, you possess completely independent power. You are independently powerful. So he is saying, Kapilam Drapadhe, to that personality, Lord Kapila, who has manifested, who has descended, now I surrender completely. So Prabhupada explains this very beautifully, that Veda Vyasa, right in the very beginning, he is offering his obeisances unto son of Vasudev. What is that verse? Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. I offer my obeisances unto son of Vasudev, Vasudev. Why? Is Vedavyas offering his obeisances right in the beginning of Srimad Bhagavatam to some ordinary personality? Prabhupada explains the difference between Bhagavatam and other Vedic literature. Prabhupada says Bhagavatam is not talking about God.
Bhagavatam is talking about samam bonam, absolute truth. Because people may bring so many gods, Ishvara, there are so many controllers. But samam bonam, the absolute truth, that is one single personality. And he is offering his obeisances right in the beginning to that absolute truth. So then one may wonder, how do we know he is absolute truth? Yes. Vedavyasa further says, Janmadiyasya yatanvayat itaratascharthesu abhignaswarat. Correct? And then finally he says, Satyam param dhimahi. I offer my obeisances to that Satyam param, absolute truth. I meditate upon him, dhimahi. You see? So, Prabhupada says, Veda Vyasa is not offering his obeisances to relative truth. He is offering his obeisances to absolute truth, Satyam Param. And who is that absolute truth? Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. So, very beautifully Prabhupada explains, right in the beginning, Veda Vyasa is offering his obeisances unto the absolute truth, who is son of Vasudeva, Krishna. See? So, this Param is described by Veda Vyasa very beautifully. How do we understand he is Satyam Param Dhimahi? So he says that anything we see in this material world, the whole material creation, this material creation has only three phases. It is created at certain point, it is maintained for some time, and finally it is dissolved. Right? It is created, maintained and dissolved. So Veda Vyasa says, Janamadi, beginning from creation. Janamadi, that means creation, sustenance and dissolution. Janamadi asyaha yathanvayat. It is all done by that Supreme Personality of Godhead. He is the origin, he is the maintainer, and in him everything is dissolved. That is the meaning of Param, Satyam Param. That is how he qualifies his statement of what is the meaning of Satyam Param. So we can call somebody as Satyam Param from whom everything emanates, by whom everything is maintained, and in whom everything is resting after dissolution. He can be called Satyam Param. So here we can see Prabhupada is very nicely explaining this concept. Prabhupada is saying, the six opulences are indicated here by Kardama Muni, who addresses Kapila Muni, his son, as Param. The word Param is used in the beginning of Srimad Bhagavatam in the phrase Param Satyam to refer to Samambonam, or the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Then Prabhupada is saying, Param is further explained by Kardama Muni in the next word. He is Param Pradhanam. So, Pradhanam, which means the chief, the origin, the source of everything, Sarva Karana Karanam, the cause of all causes. So, the Supreme Personality of Godhead He is the cause of all causes. So in the purport of Srimad Bhagavatam, first verse, Prabhupada explains very nicely. Generally, when one is very inquisitive, philosophically, when one is bent in that direction, immediately one wants to know the origin of everything. And Bhagavatam gives direct answer. Krishna is the origin of everything. And then Prabhupada explains in that purport, the atheist with the poor fund of knowledge, they do not believe that there is a creator behind everything we see in this material world. Right? The foolish people may not believe, the atheistic people may not understand. But one who is philosophically inclined, he must search out that absolute truth, that supreme personality who is behind everything. And that supreme personality of Godhead, Bhagavatam explains, he is also abhigna. He is not some dead stone. Okay, one may consider that yes, the definition of absolute truth is from whom everything emanates, by whom everything is maintained, and in whom everything rests after dissolution. But then, what is the characteristic of that absolute truth? So Bhagavatam says, abhigna swarat. That absolute truth, he is abhigna. He is completely conscious. And what kind of consciousness? Independently, supremely conscious. Prabhupada gives an example of what do we understand by supremely conscious. Prabhupada says, just like in Bhagavad Gita also we understand, sarvashetreshu bharata. One may be conscious of pain and pleasure of his own body. We are not conscious of every living entity's pains and pleasure, isn't it? But the Supreme Lord is conscious of all the fields, all the bodies, everything. Just like in today's verse we are reading, he is conscious of past, he is conscious of present, he is conscious of future. That is the difference. So one may say that yes, okay, abhigna, we are also abhigna, and the Supreme Lord is also abhigna. So what is the difference? So first Bhagavatam explains the origin of everything is the Supreme Personality of Godhead, emanates Janamadiyasaha. And not only that, he is abhigna, he is completely conscious. So then one may wonder that what about living entities? They are also conscious. But they are not supremely conscious. That is the difference. Itaratas charteshva abhigna swarat. And Supreme Lord is completely independent. Then one may think, okay, that is fine. Living entities are not supremely conscious. But then there are many other devatas, the great personalities. Like Brahma is there. What about them? Are they also not supremely conscious? So Bhagavatam explains, no, tene Brahma hridayadi kavaye. Even that Brahma, who is supposed to be the creator of this material world, even he was not in knowledge. Even he was given knowledge by that Supreme Personality of Godhead in his heart. And what about other great devatas? Shiva and other great personalities are there. No. Muhyanti at surayaha. The illusion created by the Supreme Lord is so great. Tejovari mridam yathavini mayo yatratri sarga amrsha. That this material world, which is made up of tejo, vari, mrida, all these, it appears to be so factual that even great, great saintly people, great, great suras, all these great, great demigods, even they are bewildered thinking this material world to be factual. You see? But the supreme abode of the Supreme Lord, that is completely free from the influence of any of these modes of material nature. Anyone remembers that in the first shloka of Bhagavatam, that supreme abode of the Lord, it is free from this illusory effect. Dhamna swen nirastakuhukam satyam paramadhimahi. So, we can see the first verse of Bhagavatam, how very nicely explains. The first verse of Bhagavatam compares that supreme personality of Godhead with respect to living entities. Compares that supreme personality of Godhead with respect to both the energies of the Lord. Material energy, that material energy illusion is created by that supreme Lord. And then compares to even great demigods. Whether it is Brahma, whether it is all kinds of great personalities, they're all bewildered by the illusion created by the Supreme Lord. But the abode of the Supreme Lord is completely free from that illusion. And that Supreme Personality of Godhead I meditate upon. That is what Veda Vyasa is saying in the very first verse of Srimad Bhagavatam. So, Prabhupada further explains some of the other very interesting concepts. The Supreme Personality of Godhead is not formless. He is Purusham or Enjoyer, the original person. He is time element and is all cognizant. He knows everything, past, present and future, as it is confirmed in Bhagavad Gita. So in Bhagavad Gita, the Lord confirms, I know everything, present, past and future, in every corner of the universe. The material world, which is moving under the spell of the three modes of nature, is also manifestation of His energy. So, this material world, in yesterday's class we were seeing, Prabhupada was explaining very nicely about, in Vedic literatures it is said, just like a big fire, it is situated in one place, but the presence of that fire can be felt even at distance by its two energy, heat and light. So Prabhupada was comparing, spiritual world can be compared to heat, material world can be compared to light, something like that. Even? Or vice versa. So like that, just like Goloka eva nivasati akhilatma bhuto, the Supreme Lord present even in the spiritual world, He doesn't have to walk out of the spiritual world. Right? Vedic literature also says the Supreme Lord never leaves the abode of Vrindavan. But by the manifestation of His energy, so Prabhupada says, just like if a material thing can be so powerful, sun can be so powerful, it is situated in one place, billions and billions of years it is giving out heat and light, it is not diminished, isn't it? So the Supreme Personality of Godhead, He can be situated in Goloka Vrindavan and everything can be maintained by Him, by His energy, just like heat and light maintains everything.
So this whole material manifestation is actually one of the energies of the Supreme Lord. So Prabhupada is quoting that verse from the Vedic literature. Parasya Shaktir Vividheva Shruyate. Varieties of multifarious energies the Supreme Lord possesses. Of course, we can categorize them as marginal, external, internal. But there are so many divisions in that. In that itself, there are so many divisions. Just like even in the spiritual potency, there is Sat potency, there is eternity potency, there is Chit potency, there is Ananda potency, Halladini Shakti. So many different divisions are there. So Parasya Shaktir Vividhe Vashruyate. And then Prabhupada is quoting from Vishnu Purana. Parasya Brahmana Shaktir Tathedam Akhilam Jagat. Everything, the manifestation we see in this material world is actually the Shakti of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. And then Prabhupada is explaining about this verse, Lokapalam. Just like in the Vedic literature it is said, Nityo Nityanam Chetanas Chetananam. Everything is maintained by the Supreme Lord. Not only He creates, not only He dissolves, but factually everything is maintained by Him. Even though there are so many other living entities, Nityo Nityanam Chetanas Chetananam Ekova, that one Supreme Lord maintains all the living entities. Everything is maintained by Him. That is His, but no one can maintain God. He maintains everyone, but no one can maintain Him. That is His Swachhanda Shakti. He is not dependent on other. Someone may call himself independent, but he is still dependent on someone higher. The personality of Godhead, however, is absolute. There is no one higher or equal to Him. And then finally, Prabhupada talks about very important concept which the Lord, which is revealed in this verse, Atma Anubhutya. That means, the Supreme Lord, whenever He descends in this material world, He descends in His original body, spiritual body. So Prabhupada quotes about and talks about that concept, that how Avajananti mama moodha manushim tanumashrita. Foolish people, they consider whenever the Lord descends in this material world, they think He has taken the body of this material nature. It is foolishness. The Supreme Lord does not. So first of all, He is not formless. He has a form. He is Purusham. He is Abhigna. He is completely cognizant. And whenever He descends, He descends in His original absolute form. That is also very important. We saw that, no? Ananta Rupam. And that Rupam, when the Supreme Lord descends in any of His form, that is, that form is Atma Mayaya. That is Atma Anubhutya. The Supreme Lord descends in His original form. So we'll stop with this. Grantharaj Srimad Bhagavatam Ki Jai, Jagat Guru Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai.